Expansion Zone with Sonia Barrett.
Everybody's talking about consciousness. Everybody wants that eternal kiss. Everyone's saying there's more than this. Everyone wants to follow their own bliss. Talking about one love, one blood, one life, and everyone, one life, for each other.
On the Expansion Zone, we examine life and our quest to understand who and what we are and of the vastness of human potentials. We explore the making of our world from quantum physics to parapsychology, health, sociology, and philosophy, along with practical living. You are reminded of the possibilities in creating personal change. So for an hour, we'll stimulate and expand the mind. Well, welcome once again to the Expansion Zone with Sonia Barrett. I'm, of course, your host, Sonia Barrett, and delighted to be here sharing this Monday with you, this very interesting week or last 2 weeks that we've been part of. But I'm happy to be here on this Monday to chat with you and to share with you some more insights, because life, of course, must go on. But before doing all of that, the reminder that I'd like to just make today is that, and just throwing this at you, is to remind you that fear is really it's a necessary response tool. And it alerts us to things and conditions that may threaten our survival. So we understand that. Or sometimes what we simply perceive as a threat. However, we do have a responsibility to ourselves, and that is to know when to reel back so that we may have more clarity in perhaps the choices that we're making. When we reel back a little bit, we're able to better handle then the manner in which we react. And we're in a very reactive period, and so despite everything that's going on, it's really important that we do find some sort of center, personal center for ourselves. Otherwise, we get caught up in the vortex of fear, and it just spirals out and out and out. But anyway, we have to get a handle on how we react, and that's just across the board in life. So there's a couple of quotes that I really think is so appropriate for right now. And the first one is, you only feel powerless because your fear has given your power to the object of your fear. Once you realize this, you can claim it back. So let me read that again. You only feel powerless because your fear has given your power to the object of your fear. Once you realize this, you can claim it back. And this is by Kamand Kajori. And there's a second quote also by Kamand. What you choose also chooses you. Kamand Kajori. So what you choose also chooses you. And so these are two really, I think, powerful quotes to sort of really think on and see just how much actually comes out of that, because it does sort of cause you to stop in the moment and go, wait a second, especially what you choose also chooses you. Well, what does that really mean? And just looking at your own position right now in your thought process then, in all of this and everything that's going on. So today's topic is actually going to be about the power of will and personal power. But based on the guest that we have today, Jay Morrison, I'm going to say it is the power of will and personal power in rising from poverty to wealth, which is really his story. And so I'm looking forward to having that conversation with him and getting some insights about his experience, his process in moving through these various stages in life to where he is at this time. Will, drive, determination, perseverance, and focus are all essential in navigating our lives through rough waters and in just riding the waves of life. Life is about possibilities. And for some, there is great difficulty in tapping into those possibilities. So today we will chat with someone who has clearly done so and now and encourages and educates others on making those same leaps in life. So, a bit about his bio here. Jay Morrison is an educator, business mogul, influencer, and the CEO and founder of the historic Tulsa Real Estate Fund, the first Black-owned real estate crowd fund, and the Jay Morrison Academy, a financial institution which was named Inc. 500's 13th top financial institutions in 2018. Beating the odds after growing up in poverty, dropping out of high school, and serving time in prison for drug trafficking, Jay was able to turn his life around by breaking into real estate and becoming one of the industry's biggest influencers. This path would not only keep him off the streets, but would eventually lead him to build 2 8-figure businesses, teach 50 inner city corner classes across 26 cities, and author 2 best-selling books. Now, his websites are mrjmorrison.com and also jmorrisonacademy.com. I am really very excited to have a conversation with him today because talk about the human story or one's story that reflect what so many go through, and not everyone has the ability to rise. So to talk to somebody that has experienced that, I think is of great benefit, particularly perhaps now. So, Jay Morrison, welcome to the Expansion Zone.
Oh, thank you for having me. Thank you for such a warm intro. And it is my absolute pleasure, Sonia, to be on the show with you today.
Oh, thank you so much. Now, I have to say that how I really found out about you is my older son, Corey, is a huge fan of your work. And so he, this was maybe some months ago, but no, last year sometime, he says, you've got to see this Jay Morrison and what he's doing. And I was just very thrilled to see that. So it's really good to have you here. Now, one of the things, I guess, is to start off, I think it would be a great idea. Of course, you used to tell him the story, but this is just a brief summary of your circumstances of survival that finally led to your drive and determination just to rise, you know, from those circumstances. So you don't have to go into massive detail, but just to give a reference point so we can start from there.
Yeah, I often say I believe that, you know, God gave me a very interesting journey and testimony. And I believe it's a specific one to help relate to people who come from underserved environments on many, many different levels. And so, you know, through life, I've been thrown the obstacles of growing up to a teenage mom. I mean, I think I had obstacles before I was even born. My mom was nearly forced by my grandparents to get an abortion and literally had to get up off the table in order to claim that she would have me. Mm. So I've been facing obstacles from the very, very beginning. But I was born to a teenage mom, and, you know, we were born in a small town in Somerville, New Jersey. Born in poverty, went through growing up, experiencing living below the poverty line, the free lunch, you know, in schools, the food stamps, the WIC, the Section 8 in government services. I even remember receiving Goodwill clothes from Goodwill Services for Christmas when we couldn't afford any Christmas gifts. And so growing up in that environment and then with some of my parental figures and family figures who were either addicted to drugs or selling drugs or in and out of prison. I grew up with just different kind of role models, if you will, and what was acceptable and not acceptable. And also grew up with some abuse in my home and grew up, kind of angry and on edge. And then in my teenage years, ended up dropping out of high school and attaching myself to what was closest around me. And when I saw success, which was selling drugs on the corner, I remember working for some of my older cousins on the corner and trying a way to, feed myself, et cetera. I ended up going back to high school and graduating from an alternative program, but still was involved in the streets and had started scaling my business in the streets as I was seeing more success, if you will, as a late teenager. And just 4 months after graduating high school and 4 days after I turned 18 years old, I ended up getting locked up and incarcerated in Harlem, New York, for a loaded handgun and a quarter kilo of cocaine, and was facing 3 years to life in prison at 18 years old. Went through the journey of prison in Rikers Island, C-74, Mod 3 Upper, and went upstate New York to prison and wasn't reformed in jail, actually only learned more about criminal activity. And so I came home at 19 years old after serving a year in prison and went back to the streets and inevitably landed me two more felonies and about another year and a half in prison in Maryland and New Jersey. And so I went through that whole cycle and still did not give up on my street endeavors and my street entrepreneurship, I call it, until after learning about real estate at 22 years old and mortgages and financing and credit, I took a serious shot at real estate and I left the street corner and really gave my talents and gifts a shot in a legitimate space. And I got into real estate full time at 25 years old. And that began my journey as an investor, as a developer, also as a real estate professional and finance professional. And I just used a lot of my tenacity and resilience, and a lot of what I learned through the streets, I used it to build at that time a multi-million-dollar real estate business. And later on in my late 20s and early 30s, began to build my brand and to write books. And more importantly, by age 32, I found my purpose. Which I found that it was bigger than me, it was bigger than making money, it was bigger than flipping houses, but it was about how I can serve people. And I bought into that as I was, went through some cool things, working for Sotheby's and NBC and other platforms that I was able to attach to. But more importantly, just from an adversity perspective, I went through a divorce, I went through a bankruptcy. I've been through probably most of what anybody could relate to. I have been through, but, by God's grace and strong willpower, I've been able to persist and persevere and to find myself in a space where, we've created a pretty strong enterprise and historical company with the Tulsa Real Estate Fund and have been able to serve hundreds of thousands of people over the last, several years. And so I'm no stranger to adversity.
Wow, that is such a profound story. And, yes, we all have our stories, but I think the beauty of your story is it's not just a story that you tell over and over, but it's the fact that you actually keep growing. You keep expanding. Sometimes people don't do that. They just keep being a victim and telling that story. And this is what I love about what you're doing, because you're saying, look, this is what happened to you, but you don't have to continue to make that your story. You can use that and build from it, grow from it. So,
absolutely.
Yes. And so I guess one of the things I was going to ask you, and you may probably have answered that anyway, is what moment was there specifically a defining moment that you can think of in your mind? And I'm asking you that because I remember in my own life of some moments that were defining moments where I just said, okay, no more. Did you just sort of roll into this discovery in terms of, the real estate and all of that? Or was there a moment that you just said, I'm done, I got to change?
Yeah, Sonia, there were two defining moments I'd love to speak to. One I briefly covered, which was a moment in my life where I was approaching 25 years old. My daughter, who's now 20 years old, who goes to WashU in St. Louis, one of the top colleges in the country, she was 7 years old. She was born while I was in prison. And I was approaching 25, and I was a three-time felon. I had no college education, and I still was selling drugs. And I was in a very violent neighborhood in North New Jersey, South Tennessee and Springfield, where I was hustling and I was maneuvering these street corners. And approaching 25, I had to ask myself, you know, again, taking control of my story, right?
Right.
I had to ask myself, from 25 years old, approaching 25 years old now, and all, the only skill I have is selling drugs. And apparently I'm not as good at it as I thought I am, because I've got three felonies in three different states and served 2.5 years in prison. And I'm hustling and selling drugs around, quite frankly, to be very transparent, some of the most violent and aggressive people that, you know, you probably would encounter, and people that have lost hope. And so I had to ask myself, where would I be when I'm 30 years old? I'd give myself an honest story audit, right? Where will my story end if I continue down this journey? And I could only imagine for myself being dead or in jail. And I actually tried to remix the story. I said, no, I think I could beat the streets. And even in trying to reimagine my predicament, I literally could only picture myself with a tan suit on behind green bars. And I literally could picture myself laying on the black concrete near a tan curb with my head leaking with blood. This is a very vivid picture of the vivid image that was in my head at 25 years old when I'm thinking about how my story ends. I can only picture those two things. And not accepting that to be how my story ends, I knew it was only up to me to change that direction. And I knew my daughter couldn't be proud of me with me going through her career days and her daddy-daughter days. And I had to lie and say I was in real estate when the only bricks I was a part of were the ones in the street. And I knew my mom couldn't be proud of me. And so that day, I literally just made a conscious decision to give the rest of my drug product away to my partner, to crack my phone, what we call my trap phone, my dealer phone. And I literally challenged myself to say, hey, if you are a drug dealer, cool, you only can sell drugs. But if you're a true hustler, a true entrepreneur, you should be able to hustle anything. And if you really got these talents and gifts, and you really think you're the man, I thought I was the man, if you really think you're the man, you should be able to go into any space and be the man, not just in the streets. And so I literally walked away from the street corner that day, cold turkey, and started calling old relationships that I had met while on parole who were a part of mortgage companies and real estate companies. And I said, I want to try real estate full time. Like, what would happen if I took the same energy that I spent getting up 5, 6 in the morning and, you know, doing 16-hour, 20-hour days in the streets and all the forecasting I did and critical thinking that I had to use in the streets? What if I put those talents and that resilience and that innovation, what if I put that to use in a different space? And so I challenged myself and ended up, you know, acquiring my first 3 properties my first year, 6 properties in my second year, and end up, you know, owning millions in real estate, dozens of transactions as a mortgage professional, real estate professional, et cetera. I made my first million by 28. Second part to that story, I made some good money. I still had not totally built financial responsibility. I was so transactional in how I made money. It was all about the transaction, and it wasn't about financial responsibility. It wasn't about residual income. It wasn't about I thought the money would never run out. And I ended up blowing money fast, and the market crashed, and I was, you know, into all the wrong things. Although I was not doing illegal activity, I still had not picked up strong entrepreneur habits and a level of financial maturity. So I ended up blowing all my money and going bankrupt and broke. And I remember after that happened, I really wanted to quit on entrepreneurship. I had started searching for jobs, and I was talking to my ex-wife at the time, and I'm like, you know what? I want to be a fireman. So I started actually applying to be a fireman. And her brother was a merchant seaman, and he would go out for 7 months on sea and make pretty good money. And I was like, you know what? I got a plug to be a merchant seaman. And I tried entrepreneurship. I tried the streets. It just ain't for me. It ain't work. And I literally was quitting. I literally had drove to Virginia and packed my stuff. And one of my old proteges, a guy that I mentored in 2007, who made his first 10 grand working with me, and actually made about 90 grand working with me, he called me and was like, this ain't you. He said, ain't nothing wrong with being a fireman, nothing wrong with merchant seaman, but that ain't you. And he literally drove to Virginia, and he came and got me. He forced me and said, you know, I know the market kicked your butt. I know you're depressed. You're not feeling yourself right now. I know you were the man, and now you lost your car, and your house is in foreclosure, all those things, but it ain't you. And so I then kind of mentally rebounded. And I went through a small kind of depression slash soul searching. And in about a year, year and a half, and through some mentors and through some words of advice and through challenging myself, I end up basically bouncing back, re-entering the industry, setting some new goals for myself. And again, I found some spiritual alignment and started challenging myself and thought about all the resilience and things that I made it out of and I made it through and I used my prior obstacles and my prior journey and where I persisted through, I used that to inspire me to get to that phase of my life. And I was able to re-enter the industry, reinvent myself and go on in about 8 or 9 short years to build this national brand.
Oh, I love that story. One of the things you said that I really love is that honest story audit. I am telling you, that is so crucial, and a lot of people don't know how to do that. You were able to take an honest assessment, a truthful look at yourself and where you were and what you were doing. If you cannot do that, that is a sure recipe for disaster. But yeah.
If you can't honestly evaluate yourself, all is lost. If you're going to lie to yourself, your whole journey is going to be made up off a lie and a faulty foundation.
Absolutely. And you basically, it's almost like you looked at my notes here, because I did have a note question here where it was, what was it like in the beginning? And it was, were there moments of disappointment? You know, were there supporters? And you immediately answered those two questions. So I was curious about that, because when you undertake any kind of journey like this to pull yourself up, there's going to be discouragement. I mean, and you made it, and then to fall again, you know, that's a tough one. But it built you, because if you didn't fall, if that didn't happen, would you be where you are today? You know, you learn so much.
Yeah. And, you know, even as I go through, you know, different level of struggles now as an entrepreneur and as a father and husband and everything else, you know, life is life. Life is full of curveballs.
Yep.
It's about how we deal with them. And so I think about, I'm sorry for being such a talker.
No. I want you to, because your story is significant. It's not just about real estate. It's not just about the fact that, you know, you went through the route of crime and all of that. It is the human story. And a lot of people have gone through this on different levels.
Yeah. And so I remember my first 9 months in the real estate. So when I left the streets, I didn't have much money. I had about, you know, 30 grand, a diamond chain, and 2 watches. And I still had the street life mentality. So I ended up blowing through all my money in about less than 4 or 5 months. And so I found myself flat broke, borrowing money from my mom. I had decent credit because I worked on my credit, learning about credit when I was on parole. But I had no money, right? So I'm driving a 93 Mercury Grand Marquis with the driver's side door handle missing. I had to stick my finger in a hole to open my door.
Good times.
Good times. I had to have a portable DVD player in my car to play CDs. I had no CD player. And I would park around the corner when I met clients. And so I'm doing mortgages. I had my real estate license. I owned a 2-family, but I was only barely breaking even. And so I'm struggling. And I only closed one mortgage deal, made $2,500 off one deal in a matter of like 8 months. And so I'm now flat broke. I'm not used to this. You know, I had hustled since I was 15. I always had some kind of money. Even when I was in prison, I had money. And now it's the first time in over 10 years that I'm actually broke again, right? I grew up in poverty. I hated poverty. I hated, like, it would be an argument in my household to ask for a dollar slice of pizza, right? Like, things that we think are common these days. Like, hey, mom, can we get McDonald's or can we get a slice of pizza? That was a thing. You know what I mean? Like, that was,
right.
You know, a $10 pizza pie was a family conversation. And so now being in a position where I'm broke again and 25, 26 years old, I was ready to go back to the streets. I literally started calling my old comrades from the streets and asking them, you know, what were the new prices, what was going on out there. And I was about to give up. And the month that I was going to give up, I ended up closing 7 mortgage deals and I made $13,000. And then the following month, I closed a pipeline of deals, mortgage and real estate deals. I made $30,000. And I was like, yeah, I'm back. Mm-hmm. And a few months later, I closed a foreclosure opportunity and made $93,000.
Wow.
And didn't look back since then. But my point is that I was literally to the point in the brink of giving up on myself, giving up on the aspirations I had and the goals I set. And sometimes we got to understand that seeds take time to grow and to be nurtured and to harvest.
Right, and to also change old patterns.
Right, all that, yep. And so that was an interesting time and a patch for me, but it keeps me persistent and resilient to my goals today. Had I went back into the streets and not had those months or had quit sooner, who knows what track I'll be on right now. It likely wouldn't be a J. Morrison Academy or a Tulsa Real Estate Fund or a Legacy Center, et cetera. And so, just talk about the resilience, persistence, the optimism, but also, like you said, having good people around you. And so, you know, I had people that believed and saw my potential, and that's really where I won, is that although I was rough around the edges, there were people that saw my potential, like John Wenzel, who was my first mortgage company manager, who taught me the game, like from scratch, how to fill out a 1003 in a loan application, and taught me words and phrases I never knew, taught me how to use an email for the first time in my life. I was 25 years old and never used an email. People like, you know, Pastor Antoine Thomas and people like Emery Jones, who saw me depressed, who knew I had real estate success and was like, hey, dude, you need to do what you do best. And don't try to do music. Don't be a party promoter. I was trying all these side hustles to get back on my feet. And he's like, you know, when I saw you, you were the real estate guy. He was like, go do what you do best. And I went and followed that advice, and I pivoted quickly. And I was intentional about it. And I went and got back into the industry. And that's really where, again, these words from mentors, these small encouraging words can do wonders for, you know, our transition sometimes. So I'm having those supporting people in my corner who believed in me and believed in my potential was critical to my growth.
Oh, beautiful. Really, really just awesome. We're going to take a quick break, I think. Yeah, let's take a quick break. And when we come back, we're going to continue this conversation and go from there, because real estate has been the thing throughout the ages, really, where so many have made wealth and generational wealth. So stay tuned and we'll be right back.
Hi, I'm Jack Black, and you're listening to KPFK Pacifica Radio in Los Angeles, online at kpfk.org.
It's extremely important to have public stations like KPFK that are not controlled by corporations and have an independent voice. You feel like you're listening to the voice of reason. When you're going through the dial and hearing just a bunch of noise and advertisements, and you find these little oases of sanity in the midst of all the noise.
Woo! And we are back. Of course, you're listening to KPFK 90.7 FM in Southern California. And this is the Expansion Zone with Sonia Barrett. I am, of course, your host, Sonia Barrett. And we've been chatting with my guest, J. Morrison, who is, wow, how do I describe him? he knows how to rise from the lowest of lows on up and now helps others, teaches others. He is a master in terms of real estate. And I just think overall in terms of life, knowing how to dust yourself off and pull yourself back up. And he is, let me also mention, because I'm going to have you mention that as well, talk about it, but the J. Morrison Academy, if anybody wants to go look at the website right now, jmorrisonacademy.com, and his other website, mrjmorrison.com. All right, so now, yes, right before the break, I mentioned the one thing that we're not really taught, you know, because you've talked about that before, and in terms of school, in terms of education, the educational system coming out of high school, people really are not prepared or taught entrepreneurship or anything about the oldest thing well, it's one of the oldest professions, sort of, is real estate.
Yeah, I agree.
So, yes, so now you are teaching others, you're sharing this information with young folks who, some of these people don't know what to do after high school. That is, you know, for some people, even they might not even have gone through high school, or whether they decide not to go to college. This is an everybody possibility, right, Jay?
Absolutely. You kind of hit on it. When we really think about it, think about any industry, right? Whether even if it were like bartering back in the, you know, first century the world was in existence, right? The first decade, the first year, right? The world was in existence. And you were to barter some fruit or vegetables on your land for somebody else and what they have, right? Or whether that were for wood, or whether that for any kind of stock. When you think about all these commodities, what do they all have in common? They're all, they all come from the land. They're all parts of the earth. Real estate is only your sector of the earth, right? And everything that we particularly produce comes from real estate. And so it really is the world's oldest industry in regards to your ability to leverage the land. And, you know, why real estate makes sense is because as the human population grows, we grow, right? We can create all the cars we want. We can, you know, create all the jewelry we want, but God ain't making no more land, as my mentor has said it. And so it's supply and demand, but also if you bring it to modern day, many of us say, well, I'm not really in real estate, right? I don't want to be in real estate. And so I often ask people at my lectures and my seminars, I ask a room, and we can even ask our radio audience, although we can't see you right now, but if everyone were to raise their hand, I want to ask, you know, who here, who listening to our voice, who here lives somewhere? If you live somewhere, raise your hand. That would be the majority of us. Right.
But even so, if you don't live anywhere, you're still on the land somewhere.
Right. Even if you, God forbid, you're laying under a train track right now, you don't particularly live anywhere, you're still on land and somebody's property. Right. So no matter what, whether we like it or not, we're all in real estate. It's just a matter of what side of the coin are we on? Are we owners or are we renters? Right.
Mm-hmm.
Your radio show, it's housed somewhere. That's real estate. Wherever anyone is listening to this show, right now, they're in real estate. The hospital you were born in is real estate. The mosque, church, or temple you worship in is real estate. Where your kids go to school, where you go to school, is real estate. The dinners you have, the hotel you stay in is real estate. Even if you're listening to this fly in the air right now, that's called air rights.
Mm-hmm.
It's part of real estate.
Right.
And so the more we learn about the world's most precious commodity, most dominating commodity, real estate, that puts us all in a position to be not of the consumer class or what we call tenants in real estate or the ones who lease, but we learn how to be the owners in real estate and benefit from all the perks of ownership, such as the equity and appreciation, the tax advantages, the residual income and rental income, and the power and control of owning real estate. So I believe it is one of the fundamental just pieces of society that we all deserve to learn, and it's not as complicated as most of us would think. It's not expensive to get into, as many of us would think. There's all kinds of no money down and creative ways and no credit down, no credit participation ways to make money in real estate. And I just think for anyone from any environment, especially those trying to climb up out of a poverty or financially challenging situation, understanding how real estate works and all the creative mechanisms around it can certainly be your come up and a tool for you to come up in life.
Now, which you probably, I'm sure, also you did kind of cover this, but just to be real specific, because as human beings, we tend to have a lot of excuses, and sometimes the excuses are just based on fear. So what would you say are, might be some of the common misconceptions then that people might have about this being a possibility for them to enter into this this real estate industry, particularly, well, young people, older people, it doesn't matter, but...
Yeah. No, it doesn't matter whether you're a veteran, whether you're, you know, young, in college dropout, your 9-to-5 job, caught in the corporate trap, I call it, or you're a guy or gal coming up the corner trap, like me, or have felonies, or at-risk youth, or GED, whatever, it doesn't matter. Many of us think that we can't get into real estate because of our credit. And probably the other half of us believe we can't get into real estate because of our cash or amount of capital that we have. And I always tell my students, whether it be at our corner class or any other events, that you don't have a credit problem and you don't have a cash problem. What you have is a strategy problem. You never learned the ways to solve what we call, AKA, these problems. I was taught that there's no such thing as problem, there's only a lack of solutions. And so there are ways to get into real estate with challenge credit. If you understood how financing and underwriting and qualifications work, you might find that your score, which you might think sucks to you, could be easily qualifiable for a 100% financing program or a 3% down program, meaning you would only have to put down $3,000 down for a $100,000 house or $9,000 down for a $300,000 property. And then you'll find out about other kinds of down payment programs and incentives, and then you'll find out about just all these cool and creative ways, even wholesaling real estate, where you can actually make money with no capital out of your pocket and leveraging none of your credit, just by simply having the strategy to find attractive deals that others want. And you can literally make money in between by assigning or selling your contract on deals that you find, that you take control over through a contract, and you can assign that contract to somebody else who will pay you a fee. It's called wholesaling real estate, and it costs you essentially no money down to do those kinds of strategies. So the biggest misconceptions is, hey, I got to have a bunch of cash, I got to have crazy credit in order for me to get into it. And I tell you, what you got to have is strategy over all those things. With the right strategy, you can overcome any cash or capital problems.
And you don't and you don't necessarily have to have a real estate license, because I mean,
that's another one.
Yeah, yep. That's another big myth. I remember years back, yes, when I was more involved in real estate. Yeah, and didn't have a real estate license, but yes, but I understood the process. So you offer, if somebody is listening and say, you know what, I really want to get involved, I don't know where to begin. If they were to be part of what you are you're offering, what would that look like for that person in knowing where to begin?
Absolutely. So we have two tracks, really. So for those who want to learn the ins and outs and fundamentals of, you know, home ownership, or investing and flipping, or being a landlord, and how do you evaluate a deal, and how do you build your team, and how do you get qualified, how do you understand financing, right? All the intricacies. We've really built out a robust curriculum called the RBCs, which focus on real estate, business, and credit. In that curriculum, you all can learn, have tests, assessments, all online. We offer weekly mentorship calls, right, for our students. And you get all that and learn more about our curriculum and syllabus at jaymorrisonacademy.com. That's jaymorrisonacademy.com, where we really have over 85 lessons that break down you understanding credit, family credit, business credit, personal credit, you understanding financing and real estate, and again, how to find these attractive opportunities. So that's one way, is through our educational website and school. And the other way is, we launched a store company called the Tulsa Real Estate Fund, T-U-L-S-A Real Estate Fund. And in the Tulsa Real Estate Fund, we actually offer working class individuals, non-accredited or accredited investors, the opportunity to own shares of our real estate company and to be a passive investor with us for as little as $500 investment. You own 10 units or shares of our company, and you can participate as a passive investor and instantly own your fractional shares of our Class A commercial space called the Legacy Center, or our 98-unit apartment complex, or the many deals that we fund throughout the country. And so you can become a passive investor and park some of your capital with us and own parts of our company and instantly be a passive real estate investment company owner, or you can go learn the game for yourself at the jmorrisonacademy.com and learn how to build your portfolio with our mentorship and tutelage.
I love this, because this is going back to the way it was once upon a time, where people were more in charge of themselves and producing, whether it be, well, farming. I mean, that's land right there too.
Yep.
You know, but before, what is it, before the crash, a great many people worked for themselves before, you know, all of that happened in the Industrial Revolution period. But I think people forget that, that was more the norm. So what you're presenting is it's giving people an opportunity to say, okay, this is what I want to do. Not only that, but you can use the money to invest in other dreams that you may have.
Absolutely.
This is the thing. This is the significant thing. So it's not just a one-dimensional thing, but you can. This is how you can also get the money to build other things. So this is awesome.
Yeah, thanks so much.
Go ahead.
Yeah, there's so much opportunity for wealth creation, leveraging real estate, whether it's just owning, the first, $10,000 my family ever had saved my whole life growing up was when my mom purchased a FHA property, 3% down. We put $3,000 down on a $100,000 house. That house went up in value about $97,000 in the matter of 3 years. And we were able to sell that property and cash out tax-free just by living there. We did no renovations, no bathrooms. It wasn't flipped this house. It was just living there. But the market went up in value, and our family, who grew up historically poor, was able to see a nice nest egg, which we were able to invest in other properties by simply living in a property. And that's why I'm such a big advocate of it, because I've seen just by doing something we're going to do anyway, which is live.
Right.
I've seen how real estate can create that kind of equity, and then you get wise enough and astute enough to learn how to tap into that equity through refinances, through home equity lines of credit, understand how to find other deals. You can then turn that money over from just living into other assets and properties and wealth-generating vehicles. It positions us to be the best CEOs of our last name. Mm-hmm. We all, in my opinion, have a responsibility to help transform and to grow our family legacies. And if many of us have inherited a great financial legacy, I think it's our job to be the leader and visionary or CEO of our last name to create that legacy for our family. And for some of us who may have been, or you, like I say us, because it wasn't me, but who have been fortunate enough to inherit a family, inheritance, make the best use of that inheritance by informing yourself on how you can invest and be educated and grow that inheritance for your family. So that's where we make this big impact called generational wealth. And it starts with our knowledge base and our ability to recognize great opportunities and put the right people around us to execute on those opportunities based on our knowledge base.
Yes, and that old phrase kind of popped into my head that he who holds the most gold holds the power. Well, that in one way, sadly, but true, that's basically how it's been. That's basically how it's been. Why there has been a tremendous amount of generational wealth from those who rule. Those are who seem to be in control. There's a lot of generational money, but you get groups of people, especially in the Black community, that did not have this kind of education. So there's not a whole lot that is continuously passed on to other generations to make it easier or to assist. And that's what you're really starting to initiate in other people's minds and in the minds of young people.
I appreciate that. Yeah, absolutely. And that's the goal, is just showing everyone that, it is possible. There's just some practical ways to do it. And to your point, we have a saying, whoever owns the most land wins. And, our goal is to try to put more people in position to take advantage of these opportunities, for sure.
Right. Now, how about the idea that everyone is not an entrepreneur? I had to throw that out there. I know we mentioned the word entrepreneur, but there is that sense that everybody's not an entrepreneur. But from your experience, from what you've seen with folks who probably would not have been considered entrepreneur, is it possible for someone to be trained, I can't think of another word, but to understand strategy enough to become an entrepreneur?
I think that's the other piece is real estate has taught me so much about entrepreneurship. It taught me how to be a strong entrepreneur. I thought at first I was just getting into it to be like a house flipper or something. And then I learned that I was actually becoming a real businessman. And I think that's another strategy or lesson that, you know, our youth should learn that can be taught in schools, because we look at all functions of life are run by business owners, right? It's all based on business. I mean, from everything I'm looking at on my desk, from hand sanitizer to markers to computers to the phone in my hand, you know, everything is run by some kind of ingenuity and innovation through entrepreneurship. And we should do more to teach youth and others how to take control of their ideas and to actually facilitate these ideas and how to bring your vision to life and finance that vision, right, through creative financing and other opportunities, so there's more entrepreneurship and more opportunity for legacy through business ownership.
Mm-hmm. And so in this particular time, if you had to give any advice, I guess, outside of what you said, in this particular climate, perhaps, where people may be so focused on everything that's, you know, going on, or more doom and gloom or more demise, what would you say, what advice would you give to someone who is in that space but wants to make some sort of shift in their life financially? Now is as good a time as any, right?
Right. Yep. And I think it really boils down to, like, being intentional. Intentional meaning doing it on purpose. So a lot of times, because of what you mentioned earlier, fear, we wait on opportunities and we delay until our backs are against the wall. And we talk about what we would have and could have and should have done. And I always look at, like, as you understand entrepreneurship, which is really someone's organizing a business but taking a greater than normal financial risk to do so. And so there's going to be risk in entrepreneurship, but I guess, like, the cool part for me and how I've always kind of computed it is, even in your wage-earning job, you're taking risk. Because there is no true thing as job stability. Any job can shut down or lay you off or give you a pink slip.
So, and they do it all the time.
Security, they do it all the time. You see it even in its climate, right? A job can say, hey, we can't, you know, there's a pandemic going on, or is anything else going on, or we can't scale. And so there is no true thing as job security in that general way. And so in entrepreneurship, you're taking a risk and taking control and ownership into your own hands, which is why we say own or be owned. And come on, there's a time and place for a job, and there's a time and place to support someone else's vision in that. But I believe that we all should at least have the general skill set of entrepreneurship, whether we decide to use it now or not. You should not be so fearful or so uninformed that you cannot facilitate or execute an idea of your own if you so choose to.
Right.
So I think it's all about having a strong knowledge base, but also being able to bet on yourself, as opposed to only betting on others or a system or whomever you think is going to take care of you. Because at the end of the day, none of those things are guaranteed.
Right. And you commit to yourself, because this is what you're saying. It's that commitment to self. And you also, I should say, you offer a certification. So through the academy, just so people know, when he's talking about the academy, he also certifies you. And I won't use the word necessarily, I'm assuming, because I know that you obviously are providing support. There are different levels of support that is probably provided to students in different phases of their learning, of their growth.
Absolutely, yeah. So, I mean, we have some online classes where, hey, you just take the classes, learn at your own pace, and, you know, you don't need us. We have some classes where, you know, we're giving you the group weekly mentorship calls. And then we have upgrades into, you know, one-on-one support, and we offer everyone a free financial game plan to see, you know, do you need help with credit services or with business funding or even getting life insurance, right, for times like this or times like we all are going to have, which is an inevitable demise. So we offer different financial resources to our students. And, yeah, through our certification as a real estate professional, real estate entrepreneur, or in business or credit mastery, that certification allows you to have better positioning when you're talking to private lenders or capital partners or coming to us for private capital or partnership. It shows that you are proficient and efficient in real estate, business, and credit. And so we're trying to constantly build out our ecosystem, build out our school, and just really offer as much value and serve as many people as we can in the space.
So also, you are very big and, I guess, active with the community. You're also a community activist. So I guess this involves the educating of folks as well. Do you want to just touch on that for a little bit?
Yeah. I'm just a big component of, we all are activists, so we all should be. We made it the term activist, so that way I think some of us don't have to participate in what's right and what's wrong.
Mm-hmm.
We can say, oh, you know what? I'm a barber. I'm not an activist. I'm a real estate guy. I'm not an activist. I don't got to get involved in that stuff. But I think we all have a duty to serve the greater good and to serve those least amongst us and serve society with our gifts. And I've just, you know, been called and I've accepted and been obedient to a calling to, you know, serve those least amongst us and to offer what I can to families and individuals I know can relate to my story, my journey, those who are voiceless and may have less resources, whether it be for political justice or human rights or civil rights or anything in between. And that also boils down to not just what we call government accountability, right, in the political activism space, but also self-accountability, right? Like, so as a member of the Black community, or what I call Africans in America, we have an obligation to pull ourselves up by the bootstraps, to hold ourselves self-accountable for the advancement of our community. And I believe a lot of that does start with education and combating our social degradation, and to start speaking highly of each other and start loving each other and to start respecting our women and start doing the things that we can do for ourselves that and no one else's control. And so one thing that we are launching that we're proud of soon is what's called the African American Repair Curriculum. And we developed a 30-point curriculum that has 15 points of social repair and 30 points of economic repair. And those social repair topics cover everything from parenting, anger management, conflict resolution, health and wellness, self-defense, and all these topics that will help repair our community through education intentionally, and also economic repair, right? So covering credit and real estate and bankruptcy law and nonprofit formation and taxes and many of the things that we just aren't taught in our community or our families don't know much of. So we created this curriculum as a free curriculum that we can align with partners that we'll be rolling out in the next 30 to 60 days. So that way, again, we are being intentional and doing it on purpose in regards to educating those who have been unexposed or underinformed to some what I call basic life principles and basic life strategies that everyone deserves.
Okay, so we have probably a little bit more than a minute left, but I think this all starts from, this is what I'm going to say to folks. Take an honesty story audit. I think begin there. begin there for sure. And then again, is there anything else you want to say about where to contact you? I gave out the correct websites, I imagine.
Yes, you did, guys. You can follow me on Instagram at Mr. J. Morrison, YouTube, Mr. J. Morrison, as well as our Facebook page, Mr. J. Morrison and MrJMorrison.com for the many different entities and enterprises. Love to have you as a student in the J. Morrison Academy or a partner in TulsaRealEstateFund.com.
All right. Well, I think we covered quite a bit, and it was such a pleasure having you on the show. And thank you so much for all that you do and continue to do. Very, very thrilled about that. Thanks so much, Jay Morrison.
Thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
Yeah, you're very welcome.
All right, have a good day.
All right. So I think that's it. But I love his story, what he shared, and it doesn't have to be the same story as his, but everybody has their own story and their own struggles that they've dealt with that they're probably still dealing with right now. And it's a matter of learning not to drag our past with us, not to keep telling the same story, but to examine the fact that if we are telling the same story, what can we change, and is it making any changes in our lives? So I want to thank you so much for joining us, and look forward to the next time that we do get together on the show. D'Angelo Jones is our engineer. Thank you so much. And to my listening audience, once again, thank you. Do visit theexpansionzone.com for the archive for this and many other things, events, that kind of thing. More about me, visit therealsoniabarrett.com. And as always, live life to its fullest and question everything. Until next time, see you then. Everyone wants to follow their own.